I'm all the way up.
We'll be right back.
Well, good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to Ron Joyce Stadium at Les Prince Field, the campus of McMaster University, the site of this year's East-West Bowl. And great potential football players will be on display here this afternoon. Steve Clark, along with Andrew Barlett, a five-year athlete from Concordia. And hey, this is a special time for these players, a real opportunity to make their mark before the season starts.
Definitely. I'm really excited for these fellas out here. I mean, we've lost the East-West Bowl for the last two seasons, and that's going to be a huge piece here. These guys are really going to take the opportunity to showcase their talents. I'm really excited for them to finally get back on the field in this East-West Bowl.
Real difficult it is for the quarterbacks. We've got Tanner DeYoung, James Keenan on one side, Josh Donnelly and Andreas Duick on the other side. We watched them go through their paces here. It'll be a challenge for them, I think, Andrew, and I don't know if you'll agree with me, with rhythm, because they're not going to be playing the whole game.
Well, yeah, so the big thing here is it's not their receivers that they're used to. They've had 1 week. The timing's going to be off. There's going to be that split in the middle at halftime. And, I mean, there's going to be different DB matchups with those receivers almost throughout the whole season, or throughout the whole game, rather. Another thing is that for the first time in this East-West Bowl, I was talking to Adam Grandy from Western, the linebackers coach there. It's actually going to be a pretty low-scoring game, he thinks, simply because the defense can do whatever formations they want. Previously, they had to do a subset of formations and declare certain blitzes, which is also going to throw off the quarterbacks a little bit compared to years past.
How about the weather conditions today? A beautiful sunny day down at McMaster, but a little bit blustery.
And the wind, the cross-field wind. There's some new buildings here at McMaster, and I'm being told from some of the coaches it's almost creating more of a wind tunnel than we've ever seen here at Ron Joyce before.
Could take a look. The teams have just done the coin flip. We'll be ready to go. The East will be in the white. The West will be in the black. You know, CFL draft just happened on Tuesday. A lot of U Sports players drafted. I'd say, 85% of the players were U Sports players. I mean, it's got to be special for these guys so soon after the draft, and here they are getting to strut their stuff.
Well, you know what's really interesting about that? I was actually speaking to a friend of mine who, a former teammate, works at the CFL head office. A lot of these CFL scouts, they actually took a red eye from their war room in order to get to campus and view these players, watch them, take their notes, and scout.
So you can see just about ready to go here. And it looks like it's going to be the West that will kick off. They are in the black.
Overall, 10 wins in the 18 years of the East-West Bowl, 10 wins for the black, or for the West rather, who's going to be in the black, and 8 from the East.
James Parker is the kicker. He's from Manitoba, and you can see he's already having some trouble with the tee as he gets the ball set up at the 45-yard line. And
that's that wind. Do you see the flags on the goalposts? That's pretty windy here, and I've played at this field before, and I've never felt wind like this before, so I think that will be a factor, once again, to those quarterbacks as well. I did actually speak to Stevenson Bone, the QB coach for the West, who's also at Guelph, and I'll speak to a few notes that he sent me as well.
So they will actually have to have a holder for Parker as he gets the ball kicked off and underway, and it's a good kick, and it's taken at about the 7-yard line and right through to the 27-yard line. The return, Parker Oliver Catterett was the return man, and we're ready to go, first down.
He's the running back, the scat back out of Sherbrooke University of the RSEQ.
So Andreas Duick from, or it looks like James Keenan from Queens will be the first quarterback for the East, and he will operate out of the pistol right away, and he's going to throw when it is caught for about a 6 or 7 yard pickup.
You know what?
On the play, and that catch was made by Chedler Fervius.
6 yard out to the short side. Might as well get a completion on the first play. It's a safe play to do. No complaints with that.
Fervius, a slot back out of St. Mary's. So they'll spot the ball just shy of the 34-yard line. Second down and 4 for the East as they try and find some rhythm, and it looks like it's going to be another throw, and it's going to be overthrown on the right side. The intended receiver, Nathan Lupien from Bishops, and the East will come on and punt.
Yeah, really going for the sticks there, just the first down. A little bit of a wobbly ball, like I said, might be the wind, might just be some early jitters. The coaches actually switched it up on us. We were expecting Dweck to be the starter, but James Keenan.
So the kicker is James Parker for the West. And that's the wind playing effect there. It's a very short punt. And there's a flag float thrown on the play back at the 52-yard line as Clark Barnes, a big slot back out of Guelph, is the return man.
Most likely a no yards. Very typical. Actually, the CFL just made some changes to their no yards penalties. Whereas coaches used to have it strategically where you would just go for the 5-yard penalty. Now they have some 15-yard penalties here. So now we're going to be starting with the West on offense.
And they will scrimmage from the east side of the field at the 46-yard line. Josh Donnelly, it looks like, is the quarterback who will come out of the gate first. And he drops the snap, picks it back up again. Very cool and composed as he rolls out to the right and completes it at the 40-yard line to Jonathan Rosary out of Alberta. 6-yard pickup on the play.
You make a really good point. Really cool, calm, collected. Looks off his main receiver. Finds the check down from running back open, but a little low.
Picks up 6 yards on the play. Donnelly is 6'3", 190 pounds out of Regina. And we've seen the quarterbacks come out throwing here in the early going. Now off the jet sweep, it's no, they're gonna keep it. And Donnelly, nice disguise. He slides down at about the 26-yard line. A 14-yard pickup and a first down.
I love that formation. So it was an empty backfield. It was a classic 42. And you had the second inside receiver was actually the running back. And it was, you could see a read option. That was a fantastic read by Donnelly to actually call his own number.
So a 14-yard pickup on the play. Donnelly, who rushed for 85 yards during the year on 17 carries. This time it is handed off. Looks like it's going to be a fairly short pickup, couple of yards.
As I mentioned before the game, talking to Stevenson Bone, the quarterback coach here for the West team. He's also the quarterback coach for Guelph. He was saying that Donnelly, great athlete, fantastic athleticism, and can run the ball. So I'm not surprised to see that. Second and seven.
He's spotted at just outside the 25-yard line, so about second and seven for the West. Donnelly has Keon Edwards beside him. He's from Western. Instead, he'll go and throw, and it is caught, but it looks like it's going to be short of the first down. Catch was made by Jawan Jeffrey out of Guelph, so decision time early for the West.
I mean, got to go for a field goal. Mind you, they're kicking into the wind, but it's pretty close. Oh, no, they're not. Might as well let the kids play. I really did like that defensive play by the outside linebacker, Ethan Martin. 6'1", 192 linebacker from Queens, preventing that first down.
So third and three. Keon Edwards is a rusher who rushed for over 1,200 yards, but he's in the block now as Donnelly. Lots of time to throw, and the pass is going to be caught on the left side. Good for a first down as James Basiliga makes the catch and darts out of bounds. Basiliga, correction.
There you go. He was pretty open there. Right to the sticks. Playing smart, getting the first down. Throwing the ball to march up the field.
And what about the move to go for it, third and three?
Yeah, not the move I would have gone. I've always been the kind of guy to keep the get the points that are on the field, but I like the bold play.
So Donnelly again empties out the backfield now. Edwards will go into the slot. Looks left again and has to throw it away. Good coverage by the East, and really a good safe play made by Donnelly.
That looked like it was a bit of a failed or a botched screen. And I would really attest that to the D-line there, holding up their offensive linemen, not allowing them to get out and work as lead blockers. Really forced to just ground the ball there.
So second down and 10, 12-yard line for the West. They are dressed in the black. They can still get a first down without a touchdown. Let's see what Donnelly has to offer up. Settles back into the pocket. This time he's looking right, goes to the left. He's going to scramble himself. He spies the end zone. Stutter step move and gets absolutely nailed close to the sticks. What a good
Maxime
tackle
Lavallee.
Maxime Lavallee with a great play.
Yeah, I was actually told yesterday by Concordia's coach Brad Collinson that Maxime Lavallee out of Laval is definitely a DB that they needed to game plan against. Just a hard-nosed play there by Lavallee, and we do hope that Donnelly's all good. He's all good.
Didn't exactly get to slide down there, did he?
I guess when you're going for the end zone, it's not really the preferred move.
Third and one, so it is now the offense staying on the field. Donnelly again kind of now will go behind center. Keon Edwards, the deep back. It's Edwards with the ball, and he dives ahead.
I don't think he made it.
Didn't get into the end zone, but the question is as to whether he got the first down. And this will be interesting to see where they spot the ball.
The D-line did a great job at just doing the submarine, making the O-line topple over. It's really hard. We don't have the cone cameras like they do in the pros. So we can't really see from that angle. It's hard to speculate.
Marcus Jean Locher was amongst those.
Oh, and they're marking it a first down.
So first and goal from the one, and I would say that was a first down by inches.
At most.
And one of the best running backs in the OUA, Keon Edwards. We might get the ball again. Let's take a look and see what Donnelly and the offense have diagrammed. Donnelly kneels behind center, handoff, Edwards, right into the pile, and he's not going to get there.
Fumble.
Second effort. Looked
fumble.
Like he fumbled the ball. The East is signaling Edwards that they've got it.
Oh, no. Fumbles on the play. He just hit a brick wall there. Like I said, that D-line's doing a really good job at holding up that O-line. The D-line there on East just clogging up the hole.
It is going to be East ball as they
Wow. On the goal line.
The pile, and there's still tug of war, and it looks like number 94, Alex Fetchin from St. FX, was the man who was at the bottom of the pile with the football. What a play.
Looks like it.
And you could see
he actually forced the fumble.
Yeah, he lost the ball early too, did Edwards.
Alex Fedgen, really good play. If he was actually the one who recovered, he was the one that forced the fumble too. So that's a great defensive heads-up play.
So now James Keenan operating under the shadows of his own goalposts. Adam Williams is the lone running back, and let's see what he does. Hand off to try and give a little bit of space, and boy, just able to get back over the goal line was Williams. He was very close to be driven back for a safety.
Number eight, Adam Williams, the ball carrier.
Once again, by inches.
Great initial pressure. Ryan Leader from McMaster playing at his home stadium. Second and 10.
Some pre-snap adjustments here.
Again, Keenan has Williams and Keenan. Handoff to Williams as they play it very conservatively. And Williams on the right side gets to maybe the 3 or 4 yard line, and the special teams will come on to punt.
So not much out of that drive, but honestly, your offensive playbook has dwindled down to a couple plays at that point in time.
Josh Heyer out of Calgary was there with the tackle. And this one here looks like, with Max Capriotti from St. FX coming on to kick, a conceded safety would seem to be the likely choice. But let's see what they do. He might boot it out.
It's really, really interesting if you think about it, because the goal ultimately isn't for a win or a loss, right? It's to showcase these players. And that's why we saw them going on third down, right? In a regular season game, you're going to obviously kick the field goal, get the points.
So I'm sure the notes are being made that Max Capriotti caught the ball and kneeled very efficiently.
There you go. And actually not even efficiently, dwindling down the time on the clock at times is the go-to move.
6:54 to go in the first quarter. The West now up 2-0, and as expected, you know, you made the point, Andrew, about the defenses maybe being slightly ahead of the offenses, and that's ranked true so far.
Well, the thing with that is when you're playing on defense, a lot of that is read and react. A lot of the terminology is the same, or you can relearn some terminology on a brand new defensive coordinator's system. A lot of these coaches coach a 4-3. That's what they're playing right now so far. Offense, it's all about the timing, all about the chemistry. When you have multiple quarterbacks going in and out, multiple receivers going in and out, it makes it difficult. And Adam Grandy was really a bit of an oracle by saying he assumes that it's going to be a low-scoring game. And so far, not a whole lot of offensive production.
Clark Barnes, Josh Uinchina back to receive the kick from Capriotti, who will tee it up from the 35-yard line. And there goes the ball, and they'll go right to the hole. They're not even going to try and kick it again. Demetrius Masuka out of McMaster will be the holder for Capriotti. Short kick kickoff, and it's taken by one of the up linebackers, Connor DeLahey, who didn't want to show off his returning skills.
I was going to say, oftentimes that's the dream when you're an up back or you're in the middle of the kick return. Most coaches will honestly, if you're at that field position, just say, "Don't. You're not a ball carrier. We don't want you to fumble it. You got these ball hawks on kickoff. Just take the knee and the field position." Right there, perfectly on the 35-yard line. Couldn't ask for a better starting spot.
So Donnelly back on for a second series here, 2-0. His team leads. They drove it down to the 1 yard line, and then Keon Edwards fumbled the ball, low snap. Donnelly picks it up, settles into the pocket, and completes it to Edwards to the 44-yard line, and a good open field tackle made by the East number 13, Zendru Audane.
Yeah, Zendru Audane from Carleton, the DB, with the downfield, open field tackle. That's probably the most difficult tackle to make, especially coming from like a field half or a safety position where there's just so much field for the running back to really scatter.
Second and 2 for the West. So the playbook is open, short as it may be. Hand off to Edwards. He's going to get the first down and a couple yards more as he goes to the right side, gets Edwards over the 46 to the 47-yard line. Needed 2, got 4, and the chains will move.
We saw some nice seal blocks there. A huge hole from Theo Benedette, the O-lineman from UBC. And then also number 60, Phil Groevic from Western. Really just allowing that hole on the right side of the West offensive line to open up.
Theo Benedette at 6'7", 290 can open up many a hole for a running back.
Both UBC tackles, 6'7", just wild.
Donnelly, another low snap. He picks it up and very composed as he dumps it off down low, and getting driven back after he reached midfield was number 15, Jacob Mason out of McMaster. Looked like a little bit of a broken play, but you made some positive yardage out of it.
Yeah, a couple low snaps so far, but you know what? I love this composure, and I love the decision-making by Donnelly.
Donnelly, 43 for 91. 8 touchdown passes during the regular season, so sub 500, but 8 touchdown passes, there's nothing wrong with that. Second and 4, ball after the forward progress was stopped at the 54-yard line. Donnelly back to pass. Flag will fly. It's completed to Clark Barnes at the 50-yard line. Maybe gets to the 49-yard line. Good enough for a first down, but we'll check the flag.
Yeah, it looked like possibly a procedure. I saw some pre-snap movement.
Again, timing will be, it's against the East. Might be an issue with some of these teams in pre-snap counts.
And that's why I'm not a ref. First and 10, starting just below the 50, around 49.
Yeah, the West will decline that penalty and take the first down yardage. And again, Donnelly has played very well here in the first quarter, settled in, and he's back to pass again. This time he's looking down the field, and as he looks down the field, he is pulled down from behind by Kyle Chappas out of Acadia.
That was actually a really nice heads-up play. You'd think that Donnelly would probably just dump the ball at that point. That definitely exceeded the three and a half seconds in the pocket. Kind of threshold that you imagine you're going to get some sort of pressure from your blind side.
Actually ended up being a positive pickup of 2 yards for the West with Donnelly, but he was looking for more. It was pretty clear. Second and 8, a little bit of a low snap. Donnelly, this time he's going to go deep down the field looking for Barnes, and just overthrew him by a couple of yards. Jason States, McLean, Felix, Petit in on the coverage. 3rd and 8.
Once again, just a little overthrown. Nice ball. The timing a little bit off. It's all part of it. East-West, it's tough for these guys. However, this year they did do the old school two-a-days. Very intensive in practice, supposedly. That's what I'm being told.
Punting team on, James Parker. Kind of a line drive, and that will bounce towards the middle. And boy, a big stick at the 5-yard line. I think it might have been Jake Kelly, maybe on the run back, and he got nailed on the play. Lake Corte might have got him. We have seen a couple big hits here in the early going.
Yeah.
This is not an all-star game by any stretch of the imagination in terms of physical contact.
Yeah, that was Jacob Biggs from Calgary, the linebacker. If anyone ever watched him, just a hard-nosed hitter. So coming from safety, that safety position, you'll see those often, not even just on those special teams.
So another long field for the East to deal with, and a handoff and a good run basically up the middle for about 8 yards. New running back into the game for the East.
Really good inside zone blocking right there. Nice wide gap.
Brought down by Lake Corte Moore.
Yeah, we see her like already. Not early on in this game, but a lot of personnel switching.
Pierre-Olivier Cadaray as the running back who just gained 8 yards. So he's lined up behind James Keenan, and Keenan will throw this time, and his receiver, Shedler Fervius, stumbled a little bit, and the ball ended up getting overthrown.
Yeah, Cadaray, we had mentioned him as the returner out of Sherbrooke, more of a scat back style. 5'8", 175. Great acceleration that we've seen so far from him.
Daniel Perry, James Vasiliga back to return. And right underneath his own goalposts, that's where Max Capriotti will kick and see if he kicks the ball away or concedes another safety.
An upback running in late.
And that will draw a whistle, and it's a timeout taken. It looked like somebody didn't have the correct personnel on. So 2-0 is our score. Minute 53 to go here in the first quarter of the East-West Bowl. First time in a couple of years this game has been played, and it's great to see these draft eligibles next year get to strut their stuff. The CFL draft was on Tuesday. We talked about that off the top, and the talent level, Andrew, in this game between both teams is pretty deep.
Yeah, there's actually a couple players who were draft eligible but actually deferred to next draft. Once we get another stoppage, I'll pull that up for the viewers and let you all know.
So Capriotti lined up again to kick. And this time he will kick the ball away. Not a bad punt considering the wind as it's driven back. Perry will take it at midfield and go the wrong way. So good downfield coverage by the East and good field position from the West as they will scrimmage from their own 51-yard line, but really wanted more after that return.
Yeah, really good coverage there from the punt team. Perry was looking for something, ended up just losing a couple yards. Decent field position to start.
So the West, as we tick down towards the end of the first quarter, Josh Donnelly, out of Regina has played the whole quarter. Keon Edwards had a big hole to scamper through, but he tripped at the 50-yard line.
I can't tell if that was a turf monster or if he actually tripped over Donnelly. He had some space. It looked like the O-line was had a nice gap. Inside zone, just tripped up. That right side of the line there for the Team West, we've seen a lot of good movement there.
So a little bad luck for Keon Edwards. Lost a yard on the play at 2nd and 11. Throwing situation as out of the gun, it's Donnelly settling back. Lots of time to throw, but he has to go underneath and the ball is caught by Jawan Jeffrey out of Guelph, who gets to the east side of the field for 7 yards, but is short of the first down.
Yeah, Jawan Jeffrey listed as a running back, but he's playing more of that inside receiver, that number three on the wide side, that H-back position, if you will, at times coming in to help block. We haven't seen him out of the backfield a whole lot yet.
So James Parker will come on to kick with 3rd and 3. Jake Kelly, one of the return men on the right side. Beautiful kick that's going to be into the end zone and trying to create something was Shedler Fervius back there, and he ends up getting dumped in the end zone. So a nice job by James Parker, the punter out of Manitoba.
Mount Allison.
MTA, I got it mixed up. I got MTA on my sheet, so.
Which to me doesn't make sense, but the confusing thing is he's on Team West, right? But that's when it's these specialists like long snappers, kickers, punters, et cetera. They do mix and match the East and the West. But yeah, a nice line drive punt.
First and 10, TV. I was never much of a geography student.
And with that rouge, that single point, it is going to go right to the 35.
Tanner DeYoung, the new quarterback, gets the last play of the first quarter, barring a penalty, and it's a sack. As Tommy Mercier from Montreal, big defensive end, drops DeYoung.
Number 12, Tanner DeYoung, sacked the play by number 91, Tommy Mercier.
Yeah, Mercier, he is a force. He's the three tech. He's the inside. He's the three tech there on the inside of the line. So the three tech being the more athletic of the defensive tackles, if you will. Between the guard and the tackle, the center and the guard, depending. I was talking to Brad Collinson, the head coach of Concordia, yesterday, and he was saying that once again he was one of the players there on Montreal that they also needed to game plan against from an O-line perspective, as he's very disruptive in the middle.
So first quarter in the books, West 3, East nothing. Andrew, anything stand out to you from what we saw in the first quarter?
Nothing that we didn't know or didn't think was going to happen. A little bit of early jitters for these gentlemen. They know there's CFL scouts all in the stands. There's also a lot of pressure, right? It's the first East-West Bowl in the last 3 years. Intensive practices. A lot of these gentlemen, I'm being told, have pretty sore legs. But once again, from an offensive perspective, a little bit of a win. Timing could be off. I'm excited to see what's going to happen for the rest of the game. I think that now that the nerves, the jitters are off, it's going to be a little bit more in sync or succinct for these boys.
Honorary coach of Team West is the legendary Brian Taurus, 36 years at Saskatchewan. 2016 was when he retired. Gary Jeffries from Laurier was the head coach from 2002 to 2012. So. Couple good ones and a couple memorable ones on the coaching sidelines.
First time they've done the honorary head coaches. They're bringing back the legends of the CIS and now U Sports, and even before CIAU coaching.
So DeYoung with the throw. Oh, it was almost a beautiful catch down the sidelines. Kevin Foster Verdier disguised it very well, brought up the hands at the last minute, but just couldn't reel it in.
Kevin Foster right there, that's the first that we've said his name, and that's the player out of Concordia. He looked just at the last second. He's actually related. His cousin is Anthony Duclair from the Florida Panthers, and his uncle, also a Duclair, also played at Concordia in the 90s. So good family lineage and also a very athletic family, but he looked up for the ball a little too late.
So Capriotti on the kick. It's another beautiful spiraling kick taken at about the 32-yard line. And a big hit on Clark Barnes, who returned a kickoff last year for a touchdown against the University of Toronto. Good field position at the 46. There is a flag down.
Yeah, the flag near the punt, the line of scrimmage, so we'll see. Beautiful kick. Probably the best punt that we've seen so far. Nice high hang, spiraling.
You can talk about the legends being recognized. A moment of silence before the game for legendary Western coach Larry Haler, whom we lost.
And that is one of the catalysts, one of the reasons that they're bringing these coaches back that are such legends. Because he wasn't able to have gotten honored in a way like this. And you did mention Taurus before. Taurus, one of the most winningest coaches in U Sports history. Really cool thing about BT or Brian Taurus is he's part of the Canadian Football Hall of Fame. His last time as a head coach was 2016. The following year, he was inducted into the Canadian Football Hall of Fame.
Incredible coach, incredible program. 1980 is when he started. Andreas Dueck now the quarterback for the West, and his pass intended for Jawan Jeffrey will fall incomplete. The penalty was against the West, so they're driven back to their own 29-yard line where they will have the line of scrimmage. And also, just a last thought, Larry Haler, the athletic director with Larry Haler, Darwin Samodiak, also passed away, and they passed away within a week of each other.
Ooh.
So some sad times on the campus of Western as they lost two figures. Really symbolic with Western athletics and the football program.
Western, the reigning Vanier Cup champions. Actually, a really cool story is that one of their players was drafted to the NFL while they were at the ring ceremony just this past last week.
That's amazing. Second and 10, Dueck from McMaster, settles back into the pocket, has to step up and down he goes, close to the 35-yard line. Reese Martin got him.
McMaster with a good lineage of quarterbacks as of recent. You obviously had Asher Hastings, you had Marshall Ferguson, you had Kyle Quinlan. And once again, I was talking to Stevenson Bone, the quarterback coach there for the West team, and he was saying that Dweck has that very, very veteran presence in the pocket, in the huddle. He commands attention and commands respect, and that's really, really interesting to hear from like a non-tangible, if you will.
He's also got Keegan Hall, McMaster, highly touted quarterback right behind him as well. So the quarterback situation is good for McMaster. It's a end-over-end punt as kicking into the wind taken by number 22, Maxime Lavallee, and it's going to be good field position for the East. It was a very short punt for James Parker, as it looks like he's kicking into the wind.
Yeah, it's hard to tell from the screen unless you're actually looking at the flags on either the goalpost or the Canadian flag right beside the Jumbotron there. But it is quite a windy day here. And I think when we were on the phone earlier today when I was calling you, I could barely hear, and I said, hey, sorry, like, I'll give you a shout back. So it was disrupting our call that much.
It was funny, the kickers were probably like, came into the stadium and saw the wind, and they're like, oh my goodness, I hope I'm kicking with the wind,
right?
At least, you know, a couple times here. Just one kicker and punter on each team, so plenty of reps for them. DeYoung, handoff. Legs churning for number 32, Kevin Foster-Verdier, as he gets a couple. Forward progress is spotted at the 42-yard line. 3-yard pickup, second and 7.
Kevin Foster out of Concordia University.
Second and 6, TVs.
Familiar place?
Yeah, yeah.
You were telling me about your football career, and I was expecting to hear statistics. Instead, I heard medical reports from
many, many injuries, yeah. That's why I prefer the booth.
DeYoung back to pass. He's from Carleton University. Ooh. And he's hit and lost the ball, but then diving on it is one of the linemen.
Ryan Ledger out of McMaster, the DN off the edge.
Van Wishart was the one who picked it up as DeYoung got pounded.
Ooh. Didn't see it coming.
Correction, James DeManoir picking it up.
Yeah, and that's when you're a quarterback and you thank yourself for wearing the flak jacket. And you have your exposed ribs and you just get knocked like that. That's a DN's dream.
Leader 6'2", 235. And I saw that happen more than a couple of times this year covering McMaster football. So again, the punting team on.
Mind you, DeYoung didn't have to worry about that because Carleton and Mack didn't play this year.
Capriotti, another beautiful punt, and it's taken in the end zone, and another single point will be conceded as
Barnes on the return.
Savan Manier-Jones not wanting to take the ball out, and it's 4-0 for the West.
It's a hockey score here. 3-1.
Oh, correction, 3-1,
yep,
for the West.
First
that point will go to the East.
There you go. Even more of a hockey score. I that's one thing I do love about Canadian football, is all these odd scoring situations with the rouges and different field position techniques. And then at the end of a game, and before it gets to overtime or during overtime, when you're fighting for a rouge, and it turns into a rugby match.
So timeout looks like was called as the West will scrimmage the ball from their own 35-yard line after the single point.
To add to your point there before, the aforementioned Brian Tauris, he's had 9 Vanier Cup appearances, won 3 of those. Vanier Cups and the University of Saskatchewan were basically synonymous with each other in the late 80s all the way through to the early 2000s. Just a powerhouse franchise of a program.
Shows you how difficult, Andrew, it is to win a Vanier Cup when a guy like Brian Tauris takes his program there 9 times and still only gets 3 victories.
Absolutely
out of it.
Wild.
Western, of course, have won a couple in the last few years under the tutelage of Greg Marshall.
Greg Marshall, not a stranger to deep playoffs or Vanier Cups with his tenure at Western, then McMaster with Jesse Lumsden, that crew, and Kwame and Kojo Adu, and then obviously back to Western in recent years.
And even took over the Hamilton Ticats and took them to a playoff spot once in the CFL as the handoff to Ewan Chinna, who goes right up the middle. Good pickup on first down, close to 6 yards.
Really interesting connections there with that kind of Marshall from the McMaster days to Tiger Cats and so on. Mickey Donovan, former Western coach, former Concordia coach, Concordia player, current pro coach, was part of that team and then joined that coaching staff and then joined him at Western, which was a huge piece of that recruiting coordinator role.
Second, and it looks like a long three. Dweck back to pass. Boy, great job of stepping up, throwing it down the field, and he overthrew his intended receiver, Jonathan Rosary. But boy, Dweck spied where the rush was coming from and had to step up in a hurry.
Carl Marchessault from the linebacker from Sherbrooke, right off the edge. A blitzing edge linebacker. No pickup at all. Really heads up play by Dweck. That's where you see that veteran presence.
And then he took a shot down the field after that. So.
Right? Not like even a grounding or a dumping the ball off to a check down.
So another punting opportunity, a line drive. Another short one. It's fumbled, though. There's a penalty flag on the play. The West did pick up the ball, it looked like, but the flag may take this turnover away.
Definitely a no yards call there, and that will get overturned. And it will be the West.
You can see that even the kickoff returners having to deal with this wind as well,
right,
in terms of securing the ball.
Yeah, so penalty on the West, like we knew. With those line drive, you know what, it really is. It's really difficult for those receivers that are used to catching these high, long punts and getting a line drive right to your chest.
And then with the special teams, it's a line drive punt that kind of hung in the air, so it's tough to stay out of that 5 yard radar that you need to.
Exactly.
DeYoung back to pass, short throw, caught right at midfield. Short pickup on the play, only a couple of yards.
I like that play call, and I like DeYoung going for that easy 5 yard, 10 yard, or like 5 to 10 yard out right there into the flats. You know, get the drive established, get some confidence, get some movement.
Shedler Fervius picked up the catch and was able to squeeze out another yard, so they'll call it a 3 yard pickup, 2nd and 7. 54-yard line just on the team west side of the field. So DeYoung back to pass. Again, quick pass. Fervius with the catch. He tries to get those legs moving for first down yardage. His forward progress might have been stopped a yard short, but we'll check it.
Really taking advantage of that cut coverage there over to the short side. With the half playing off, really able to get in the flats.
They give him forward progress and the first down.
We'll see how this drive progresses, but so far in those two plays, I'm pretty impressed with DeYoung.
I'll settle back in as we tick towards 9 minutes to go here in the first half. Not much room at all for Adam Williams as stacked up and then finished off by Jack Hinsberger, linebacker out of Waterloo.
Waterloo this past season really surprised me. You never know what you were going to get when it came to the post-COVID seasons. And Waterloo was in the top 10 for most of the season.
The game I was most looking forward to calling this year was Mac and Waterloo, and MAC defense did a great job on Trey Ford and bottled him up until late in the game.
Trey Ford, Heck Creighton winner.
Drafted by the Edmonton Elks, but is trying his luck down south. DeYoung flushed out of the pocket to the left. He's looking up. He's looking deep down the field. And it is a jump ball.
Oh.
Almost pulled in.
I don't think either DBs knew that there was an East player behind them. And I'm trying to make out the number.
Demetrius Masuka was the intended receiver who came out of nowhere. You're absolutely right.
Demetrius Masuka was actually a late addition to today's roster. There was an injury with a receiver from Sherbrooke, Charles Jehu. So Demetrius Masuka covering in for him. 6'2", 185.
Nico McCarthy, Jackson Ford were in on the coverage.
I actually don't think that they knew that he had snuck behind them.
Capriotti, another good high kick utilizing the wind effectively, and it'll be a short field or a long field for Team West to work with again.
That's the beautiful thing with the high kick, is it, being a former special teamer, being on punt, allows you to get down there, and there's a lot less field for the returner to run, especially when you almost coffin corner it. It wasn't quite a coffin corner, but we've seen on the field here, really interesting, and I really want to say that the wind, and I don't want to keep coming back to the wind, but I think it is a factor in here. On the left side of our field is where most of this football game has been played.
7:48 and running to go here in the second quarter. Andreas Dueck back on the field again for the West team. Handoff and straight up the middle. Josh Uinshina.
Simple inside zone play call, couple yard gain. Really standard play call for being in your own end.
4 yard pickup on the play, second and six from the 18. You'd love to see one of these teams' offense just be able to string together first downs and wake your way down the field. Not easy to come together as an offensive unit working with each other for only a week. Dueck and handoff, and a well-disguised handoff, and it's a first down all the way up to the 28-yard line.
Yeah, it looked like that may have actually been a read.
You went to the ball carrier.
A quarterback read, and a little bit of the stutter, I think, threw off the D-line. The O-line on that fairly simple inside zone blocking scheme was able to open up a hole. And we've seen that on the team West. The right-hand side of that line, regardless of the personnel, has been seemingly a favorite for the running game.
Uinshina again was the ball carrier, picking up the necessary yardage for first down. First and 10, 27-yard line. Dueck empties out the backfield. He'll settle into the pocket to throw, and it's complete to Clark Barnes, and he goes left all the way to the left side, picking up speed, trying to pick up some blockers. A good individual effort by Clark Barnes. Gets out of bounds at about the 46-yard line, a 19-yard pickup, and a first down.
Clark Barnes, the nice 6'2", 200-pound, lanky receiver out of Guelph. But you will see something I don't like here, and something that no scout or coach is going to like, is that he's holding the ball out. It's just asking for a forced fumble, especially on those rainy games. High and tight, ball security is the name of the game, especially in the middle of the field there where there's those open field tackles.
First and 10, 45-yard line. It's the biggest offensive play of the day for the West. And on a jet
hold.
Sweep, and there's going to be a flag thrown on the play as Savon Magny-Jones didn't get very far anyways.
Owen Mueller from the right-hand side of that line just dragged his DN down. I didn't make out which defensive end he dragged down, but it was a very blatant and obvious call for the refs.
Drew an audible gasp from the crowd is how obvious the hold was.
Right. You know what? Sometimes you get away with those once in a blue moon, but Owen Mueller taking a stab at that one.
the jet sweep, though, has really become a part of not only Canadian football, but American football, whether you're talking NCAA and NFL. You get that wide receiver who can turn a corner, it could be very effective.
Absolutely. I love the jet sweep play, and there's so many things that you can do off of it with the 12-man offenses, the wide fields, all the pre-snap motion. That's one thing I do love about the Canadian football game.
Duex pass almost intercepted by Kalen Sincere from Montreal. He had eyes wide, hands up, and had he pulled it in, it might have been coming back for a pick six.
Yeah, he's a ball hawk, and he has been throughout his career there at University of Montreal. And you see, he got the team hyped up on the sideline.
Second and 20 for the West. They lead 3-1 as we approach 5 minutes to go here in the first half, 5:05 and running to be exact, as the ball is snapped to Dueck. He looks to the right side. He escapes the first pressure, can't get past the second wave, and down he goes.
That East D line just putting the pressure on right now. Oh, there was a nice game on the inside. It looked like they did a double twist from each side. Really freed up the defensive ends. The offensive guards weren't able to track it too well.
Van Wishart, defensive end out of Queens, was the one who got some initial pressure and also helped finish off Dueck on that sack. A loss of 9 on the play.
So it's 3rd and 29.
Not too many plays in the playbook other than to punt the ball away.
Definitely
on 3rd
not.
And 29. Just going to straight line drive kick. And good downfield coverage by the West as Kevin Foster Verdier looked to try and get to the outside but found no room. And how about James Parker just whistling the line drive punt down, saying, I'm taking the wind out of play here.
Yeah, once again, we see that line drive, but Kevin Foster with that scat back style running. Be interesting to see if they have him out of the backfield in this drive. We've seen him a lot as the returner, both returning and running back there for Concordia.
4:20 and running to go here in the first half. Good field position for the East at the 50-yard line.
Quads on the open side of the field.
DeYoung gets an isolation on the right side of the field, and good attempt, but unable to pull in the ball. Retsy Daly, slot back out of York down the right side.
Really interesting how they motioned into the quads on the left-hand side of the field, and then they just had a one-on-one. They were looking for some sort of mismatch there with Retsy Daly from York. 6'2", 185 receiver, pretty lengthy.
You've seen both quarterbacks here, especially in the second quarter. Andrew, Tanner DeYoung, and Andreas Dueck, they have tested throws down the field, which is nice to see.
Very. And that's what these games are all about.
Second and 10, DeYoung pocket, collapses. Pass is complete, and right at the first down sticks at the 51-yard line of the West, it was caught by Foster Verdier.
Foster playing that number two receiver there on the open side, on the wide side of the field, with a drag right across, playing that over-under area just below the linebackers. Nice open field tackle by Ethan Martin from Queens.
Third and inches, it looks like, from maybe this, one.
From this angle, the forward progress actually did look like a first down, but we're calling it about, third and inches or so.
So DeYoung behind center. Let's see if he just moves the pile forward to get the first down. He drops the ball, it's loose. And now we're gonna have to determine who got it. But DeYoung never secured that football. And it looks like the West is signaling that they have it. And they do.
It's always hype. It's always fun, gets the energy going. I will say, however, if the East did recover, it still would have been a turnover on downs.
You prefer the turnover via the fumble recovery.
Always.
If you're the defense,
always.
Though, right?
Yeah, pad the stats. It's more fun. It gets everyone hyped up.
So that's a couple of times we've seen some, I wouldn't say miscommunication. That was a miscommunication one. Then earlier, Keon Edwards just flat out lost the ball.
Yeah. Couple low snaps.
Yep, so the West with the ball on their own 52-yard line after that turnover. On a play, Andrew, that never really had a chance to get started, really, did it?
And those should almost be a given. Any time that you have, like, under a yard on third, in the Canadian game, having to give the yard, with any decent O-line, you should be able to get that. And he probably would have, given the snap was smooth.
3 minutes warning here at Ron Joyce Stadium. The score is the West 3, the East 1. Conceded safety and a couple of rouges, all that we have to show for in the scoring.
We'd mentioned Brian Towers a whole lot. We should give Gary Jeffries a big shout out. 05, 2005 Vanier Cup winning team there with Laurier.
He also coached the basketball program in the late 80s and 90s.
That's right.
Dueck with the handoff.
He was also a coach here at McMaster following that as a an assistant coordinator, if I'm not mistaken.
Just a couple yards on the pickup for Juwan Jeffrey.
Yeah, so not a lot of coaches from the Q and not a lot of coaches from the Can West here. Reason being is that a lot of those teams had their week-long spring camps this week. And those coaches wanted to focus on their team. Actually, a couple players opted out of East-West in order to focus on their team, these being non-draft eligible guys, like quarterbacks or some specialists, etc.
Second and 10, still a great amount of talent here, but you're right, it is a busy time of year for Canadian football. CFL season a month away, the draft has just occurred. U Sports are really ramping up their spring workouts as that season will get going towards the end of August. Second and 10 for the West. Dueck back to pass, feels the pressure, and it was deflected at the line of scrimmage.
All sorts of pressure. Dueck not really given a chance there.
Alex Fetchen might have been the one who got the arm up to deflect that.
It looked like it was Alex Fetchen, the defensive end that we've mentioned there before. 6'4", 233 out of St. FX.
So another punting situation for the West, and Jake Kelly, Shedler, Fervius are back for the East, and they'll stand at around the 25-yard line. Another line drive kick, and
No yards
will be called against the West as it was taken by Kelly, and he's driven out of bounds.
I mean, good on the Gunners to actually get down the field like they're supposed to. However, it wasn't the longest punt.
It's one of those things in which if you are on that special teams, it's very hard to adjust pace when you're going down the field with a low line drive kick.
Definitely doesn't make it easy, that's for sure.
No. Maybe in the second half, with a little bit of comfort, we might get a little bit more rhythm offensively.
That's what I'm thinking.
You almost wondered if you can alternate the quarterbacks between quarters, or you can give a quarterback a half each, and they've chosen to rotate between the quarters.
Which, you know what, I'm not against. A quarter's a decent amount of time, even with the back and forth of offense to defense.
So DeJong still the quarterback, and slipping a little bit was the running back, Pierre-Olivier Cadaret, who picked up a couple yards on the play.
Speaking of slipping, that's something that we saw throughout the Vanier Cup this year at Laval with the University of Saskatchewan and Western. Both teams just slipping all over the place.
Second and 18. hindered the game, certainly.
It definitely did. It wasn't the best conditions, and I mean that's Canadian football for you, right?
Yep.
The last week of November or first week of December.
You could be playing in an unseasonably warm day, or you could be playing in a snowstorm. DeYoung back to pass, second and eight, across the middle, caught, deflected, and caught again! Well, that's one was not one that was drawn up in the playbook, and Gretzen Daly was the one who eventually stayed with the ball and picked it up.
That's something you see on TSN for the next couple of years. So it was Kevin Foster on that over-under route that we saw before, the drag right across. They were going to that same play, and it worked like a charm last time. And then Retson Daly, after a bobble with the defensive, either the DB or the linebacker, was able to come down with it. Still third and one.
Unfortunately, the end result was they were still a yard or two short of the first down, right. So the punting unit will come on.
Those are always fun and exciting to be a part of. But ultimately, you do want to get that first down out of it.
Another great kick. Barnes looking for space on the right side now, cuts up the middle and gets pounded as he darts forward. You have to give him credit. He was looking to create something.
He was looking for a crease. He was able to string it out as far as he could until there was too much pressure. But once again, you will see the ball. I will say ball security is really big in this game, and it's only going to get bigger the higher you go.
You can really see the arm moving right
yeah,
there.
You want it high and tight. And that's going to be scouted on. But you know what?
He's also got a full season to work on.
He's got
next
a full
year.
Season. I was going to say that. And that's where improvement comes in.
1:31 to go in the first half. It's still just 3-1 for the West. Andreas Dueck will continue on as quarterback. Lots of time to throw, goes over the middle, and it is through the hands of his intended wide receiver, Basiliga, as on the coverage was Kalen Sincere.
Yeah, good coverage by Sincere, also Basiliga. It's nice to see that the offensive coordinators, also these quarterbacks, as the game is going on and progressing, they're taking those shots downfield. A lot of quick checkdowns, outs to the flats early on.
Basiliga, who hauled in some Trey Ford passes to... He's from Waterloo, second and 10. Dueck back to pass again. Again has time, looking downfield, and now dumps it underneath. About a 6-yard pickup, so it will be third and four as the catch was made by Jackson Ford.
He has the aforementioned Trey Ford. NFL interest as a Canadian playing in U Sports football. You rarely ever see that. And he's a CFL hopeful, which, once again, even as a Canadian, you don't often see.
Brother Tyrell Ford also getting some NFL interest. He was drafted, I believe, I'm trying to think if it was the Argos who drafted him. Regardless, bright futures await. Good kick against the wind. And Fervius looks to try to string something out and just has to go out of bounds at the 45-yard line. A minute for the offense to work with.
I was really impressed there with Nick Thomas, the linebacker from Manitoba, able to get down almost untouched off the line of the punt team and force the tackle.
Ball spotted 46-yard line. First and 10, and another Canadian football rule coming into play, allowing for two quarterbacks to be on the field is something that might benefit the skill set of a Trey Ford if he ends up playing with the Elks.
Right? Yeah, that's a brand new rule that the CFL is implementing and Canadian football is implementing for a listed quarterback to have multiple on the offense at one single point in time.
DeYoung back to pass, screen pass, and it is deflected.
Read like a book by Josh Heyer, the defensive end out of Calgary. You know what? That's that's just being very instinctual, intuitive, and knowing that the you're never going to get in that easy off the line. If that tackle or that guard is doing their job properly, you shouldn't be able to penetrate that easily and understanding, get your hands up in front of the quarterback or peel back to where the running back is. The first thing you're taught is find and locate that running back, and he was able to at least get his hands up and break the pass.
Pierre-Olivier Cadaret was the intended receiver, and there was space for him to work with. Second and 10, 46-yard line for Tanner DeYoung out of Carleton University. Back to pass, pressured, steps up, throws, and it is dropped. And it was right there for Demetrius Masuka, the late replacement from McMaster, and it'll fall incomplete. And that was a good throw, good route run, just the end wasn't what the East wanted.
Justin Lozon, the linebacker out of Guelph, in and around the vicinity.
So now another punt, and we've seen lots of punts here this afternoon. Capriotti has really utilized the wind to his benefit, and another decent punt.
We haven't seen, like you said, a whole lot of sustained drives. And I mean, it's very common, the three-down Canadian game where it's going to be a lot of back and forth where special teams are literally a third of the game. But it will be nice and hopeful that in the second half, quarterbacks' offenses are a little bit more calm, more in tune with each other, halftime adjustments. Maybe we'll see a little bit more of that.
Daniel Perry, receiver out of Saskatchewan, was the return man on that play. 31-yard line is where Team West will scrimmage the ball. That's enough time if they're able to string some plays together. Though they are working against the wind. Empty backfield for Duwecki. Spots on the left side, and the pass is going to be complete. Staying in bounds. Tackled at the 42-yard line, James Basaliga. First down, 11-yard pickup.
Basaliga opting to go towards and try to get more field, but met really quickly.
So now they'll start to wind the clock down. Again, Duex stepping up now to the left. Still gonna go, tiptoes around one man and gets out of bounds near midfield. So some nice footwork shown by Andreas Duek as he was being chased down by Carl Marchessault.
Just missed the shoestrings by Carl Marchessault, the linebacker out of Sherbrooke. However, Duek really heads up play, was able to high step and sprint out of there and get out of bounds. 18.3 seconds left in this half. Really heads up veteran move by him. They were saying that very veteran pocket presence.
All at the 54-yard line for Duek, and now he really has to manage the clock. Again, just gets it out and then smartly heading for the out of bounds line. After picking up the first down was Jawan Jeffrey, who was the underneath receiver, and he will move the chains again.
Great speed, great acceleration, great hands, solid play all around, and then looked like he was going to just miss the sticks, but was able to get beyond the sticks, that extra speed burst right at the end, and get out of bounds.
Duek looked downfield before checking down to the speedy Jeffrey. Now you've got 9.8 seconds to go and a first down.
Smart play call.
44-yard line. Duek can't take a sack here. So he throws and it is incomplete. Great defensive play made by Kalen Sincere to break up the pass intended for Daniel Perry.
St. Cyr, a bit of a ball hawk out there, the DB from the University of Montreal. Really solid DB work by him throughout the day so far.
Now you've got 4.5 seconds to go here in the first half. You do have a timeout. if you want to try a quick pass and a quick down, but you might run out of time, or you can take your shot at the end zone, even though you're not going against the wind, or you're going against the wind. A lot of options here.
And they do opt for the timeout. They're going to game plan, make a strategic move here. Looks like there might be some personnel change on East, and they're faking us out.
Really kind of like no man's land position for the West, considering the wind today. It's too long for a field goal. Certainly Dweck has the arm strength to get it to the end zone.
Walking into your screen right there is number 77 from the West. We alluded to him, but Giovanni Manu, 6'7", 350 pounds. The wild thing about him is that he had a 32.5-inch vertical at the East-West Combine. Most linebackers can't even do that, and he's doing that at O-line.
I would just nickname him Sir.
Seriously.
So here we go. Dweck, is this the last play of the half? He will hand it off underneath and Jawan Jeffrey, and that will do it for the first half of play. 14-yard pickup, but not enough time left for another play, so that will do it for one half of play here at the East-West Bowl at Ron Joyce Stadium here on the campus of McMaster University. West 3, East 1. The defenses have really shone again, and we're not surprised, and that's no disrespect to the offense.
Not at all. It's just the nature of this game. And once again, it's only the first half. We have a whole second half of football.
Looked like the offensive rhythm had picked up towards the end of the first half. We'll see what that brings us in the second half. West 3, East 1. And you're watching it right here with McMaster's YouTube channel. Look at Ron Joyce Stadium and Les Prince Field on the campus of McMaster University, site of this year's East-West Bowl. Great to have this game back here in 2022 after a hiatus due to the pandemic. Steve Clark, Andrew Barlett here, West 3, East 1. And not to say, just to pick up a point we were saying before we went to break, not a surprise. I mean, it looks like a beautiful day, but if you check the flagpoles, it's blustery and the conditions aren't as easy for the players as you'd think.
Yeah, it's really affecting the punting game, which is obviously always going to affect the field position. From there, we already have quarterbacks that are working with new receivers. We already have receivers that are working with new quarterbacks, and the timing could be off. As mentioned, defenses can now do whatever positions they want, blitzes they want. Previously in this East-West Bowl, they weren't necessarily able to. They had to declare certain blitzes, five-man pressure at most, not a whole lot of pressure off the edge, etc. And that can also affect, obviously, the offense.
Let's take a look at some of the highlights. There have been a lot of scrambling from the quarterbacks. And this one here was that early run.
By Donnelly.
Yeah, by Donnelly. And that was the best scoring opportunity that either team had.
And it led to, eventually, the biggest scoring opportunity, which was that conceding of the safety. That goal line stand on the goal line. A lot of defensive plays here. Sacks.
There's Andreas Duet getting sacked. quarterbacks have looked pretty poised.
Very. Despite a lot of pressure, cool, calm, collected in the pocket. Very veteran presence of all the quarterbacks so far.
And there you take a look. This was actually the biggest play from scrimmage. Clark Barnes, a receiver from Guelph, 18 yard on the catch and run. Lots of notes, though, for these scouts to take it. And the one thing we should point out is that scouts aren't necessarily looking at statistics. They're looking at things that you're analyzing with the quarterbacks. You know, poise, read, all that kind of stuff.
Yeah, in matchups. How does a top, because throughout the season, right, you're going to have these top players playing against guys that aren't necessarily top talent. Actually, there was a full one-on-one, extended one-on-one session on Thursday. So CFL draft was Tuesday. All of the scouts, teams, coaches were in their war room. They, a lot of them outside of Hamilton and Toronto, took the red eye into Hamilton here to be on campus for Wednesday. Then on Thursday, they requested a longer one-on-one session. Also different with this year is that it was a unified practice throughout the week. Back to old school two-a-days, something you don't often see in U Sports football where you want to preserve the legs. They put these boys through the ringer throughout the week. Could be some fatigue legs here through today. However, it allowed them to see nice one-on-ones with receivers, with D-line, O-line, DBs, running backs, and linebackers, etc. All of those differing matchups of these top players against each other.
And scouts want to see guys with tired legs and see how they respond.
Well, exactly. I mean, the season, especially once you get in the pros, 18 weeks, only a couple byes, it really is a game of attrition.
One thing that's nice to see is I just scan the crowd here, Andrew, is the number of, you know, people I see in their university colors. It looks like there's teammates who've come down to support some of these players. I can see Waterloo, I've seen McMaster, Western, a lot of Ontario teams represented, and that's great for the game.
I saw a couple Acadia and even former teammates of these gentlemen or alma mater and alum coming back to their alma mater or supporting their alma mater that are now, say, maybe in the pros.
There was also a pretty intense touch football game going on between the universities, and I know some of the players were participating in that. That's operating in the field behind us. I'm wondering if we could transfer the cameras and hop over there and call a little touch football later on.
Yeah, so some of these OUA teams are all playing touch in a touch league with actual referees and everything.
Team Black to kick off, James Parker.
Black being the West, East being the White.
Good high, relatively short, got hung up a little bit in the wind as to the right side. It's Pierre-Olivier Catterett on the return. About the 29-yard line is where the ball will be scrimmaged by the East.
Catterett, the scat back and returner out of Sherbrooke.
So we'll see if the offensive rhythm improves. You saw signs of it towards the end of the first half of play. I'm not sure how much stuff you could do with the offensive line in terms of picking up blitzes and things like that across a halftime, but we'll see. And it's a handoff to the right side that is going nowhere. Adam Williams out of Toronto took it for Tanner DeYoung, who remains as the quarterback for the East.
So we saw the flip-flop between the quarters in the first half with the quarterback matchups and the quarterbacks. Looking like it'll probably be the same this half. Second down, TV. A lot of receiver and running back personnel changes, a little bit on the O-line as well.
So DeYoung looks like he will get the second and third quarters. It was a loss of one on the play, second and 11. He's back to pass, has to check it down, and it is dropped. And Williams looked upfield before he'd secured the ball. Third down.
Yeah, he was looking to run before he caught it. Uncharacteristic, and you know what? We haven't seen much from Williams so far, so probably that little bit of jitters to start. I expect that he'll probably be kicking himself for that, but come back stronger next series.
Williams had 367 rushing yards this year and 102 receiving, so catching the ball was not unfamiliar for him.
And not like any of those running backs that you'd see the odd one that just carries the ball, rarely gets any of those checkdowns.
Max Capriotti. Clark Barnes drops the ball, lost the ball, it's picked up. And it is picked up by Marcus Jean Loscher out of SMU, a linebacker who sprinted down the field and grabbed the turnover.
6'1", 225, just gunning down the field and picked it up after a bit of a bobble. Clark Barnes, really a top-tier player out of Guelph. Don't often see that.
So now all of a sudden the field position flips in favor of the East and they will scrimmage it. First and 10 on the right hash mark and the 43-yard line of the West. So DeYoung, pressure coming, guns it, incomplete. He was looking for Renson Daly out of York University.
The D end, the 6'5", 250 D end. Lake Court Moore in and on that pressure.
Daly looked like he had a little bit of open space to work with on that ball. So now it's second and 10 from the 43-yard line.
As we were saying before, with Lake Court Moore, 6'5", 250 as a D-end, and those massive tackles, both from UBC. Blake Neal only recruits guys that look the part.
So DeYoung's pass, my goodness. A big stick on Pierre-Olivier Cadaret, and it was his numerical counterpart, Jackson Ford, who delivered the blow.
Jackson Ford coming right downhill. That's the one thing with those wide side throws that aren't on a line. You allow the half or the corner, the free safety, whomever it is, to just come down at full speed and just crack you unexpectedly.
Little bit of a high throw by DeYoung, kind of exposed the receiver a little bit too. So now Max Capriotti is on the field, and it looks like he might be setting up for a 49-yard field goal.
He is.
So he's got the wind with him.
Taking advantage of the wind. We also haven't seen any field goals so far.
Daniel Perry stands in the end zone, hoping for a miss. So let's see the range for
and a lot of
Capriotti.
Whistles.
His longest last year was 42 yards. So he really is stretching his range. But hey, in a game like this, why not, right?
Exactly. There's nothing on the line. There's some all-star potential here. 49, if he gets it, even with the wind at his back, that's no, can't shake a stick at that, so we'll see.
Hold is down, kick is up. It's going to be short by about 2 or 3 yards, and then Edwards had it bounce over his head, and he looks to try and return it, and he gets it out over past the end zone to about the 5-yard line. So Capriotti maybe 3-4 yards short.
The really interesting thing is we do see, so that kick did not catch the wind at all. It did not get wind under or behind it. And if you do look at the flag posts on the right side of the screen, the Canada flag near the Jumbotron and the flag posts, the goalpost flags are a lot more, they're a lot more active than that on the left side of the screen. And this is really where the majority, I'd say 95% of this game.
Good look there.
95% of this game has been on the left-hand side of this field here. And there's that new building across the way. Some new builds at the end of the end zone that are getting a bit higher, so it might shelter it a bit more.
beautiful building, but yes, it's it affects the wind here. So the ball is placed at the 20-yard line as Edwards was able to get it out beyond the end zone. Dweck will remain in, and he, nice job of scrambling and completing the pass at about the 31-yard line. That's complete to number two, Edgerrin Williams.
We've spoken about the composure in the pocket. So poised there, taking an extra second, an extra read. Looked off the primary receiver, and Dweck was able to get the first down.
So Edgerrin Williams plays for UBC, but he is a Hamilton product, caught 40 passes last year. So first and 10, 32-yard line for Andreas Dweck. Read option, he picks the ball up and then was looking out to the left side, and it was incomplete, intended for Magne Jones.
Speaking of which, some UBC fans in front of us. And you don't often see that in the middle of OUA territory. However, like I said, Blake Nill goes out and gets the guys that look the part. In his first year there with UBC, won the Vanier Cup, which is almost unheard of after leaving a dynasty behind at University of Calgary. Able to, you know, have his select few guys from outside of the British Columbia area.
Second and 10, 32-yard line. Edwards will settle into the slot from the running back position. Dweck has the pocket collapse, but then he completes it out to the left side and diving towards the 43-yard line. Looks like it's going to be good enough for the first down. A nice play by Daniel Perry.
Now we're starting to see these drives start sustaining and getting built, and that momentum that we saw the little glimpses of in the first half are now actually coming to fruition.
11-yard pickup on the play. Second first down of this drive for Team West. As with Andreas Dweck, they start to move the chains. Keon Edwards, the lone setback. And it's Edwards with the ball, testing the right side. Tried to cut back to the middle and didn't find many friends there as he was stacked up as Marcus Jean Loscher was amongst those who got him.
Yeah, really good defensive stand right there on this play. Gang tackle. Keon Edwards, part of that, integral part of that Vanier Cup winning championship winning team this past season, who just received their rings at the ring ceremony 2 weeks ago.
Six 100-yard games for Keon Edwards this year, including 237 yards against Waterloo on just 20 carries.
Outstanding and consistent.
Second and 10, 43-yard line. Couple of second down completions for Andreas Dweck for first downs on this drive. He's flushed out to the left, cuts back to the right, needs some receivers to come back to him, and there he will complete it to Magne Jones, who will catch the ball at the 50-yard line and be about 3 yards short of a first down.
Yeah, it's that classic scramble drill where you have the high receivers got to come back and go low. The low receivers get some distance and go high. It's able to evade a handful of defenders from the East D-line.
Well, color me mildly surprised that James Parker comes on with a third and three at midfield. I thought there was a little bit of momentum in the West in that drive. High snap brought down, no pressure, and he looks to nice angle punt. The ball out of bounds as Shedler Fervius, the return man, could do nothing with it, but just watch it sail out of bounds. And we'll see where they spot the ball.
Pretty generous spot.
Looks like the 29-yard line. So what about that decision to punt the ball?
I don't know. When we saw in the first drive, they opted to go for it on third, and what seemed it was third and three. Instead of a field goal to get some points on the board, you'd think that this same West team might go for it in the middle of the field.
Mm-hmm. I've certainly seen a lot of notes that could be made on the punters already here this afternoon. 8:35 and running to go here in the third quarter. Wide receiver screen is going to be
nice.
Caught by Demetrius Masuka, who gets to about the 33-yard line.
that wide receiver screen, that jailbreak screen, very difficult to defend against. If you get the ball from quarterback right to the hands of that receiver, it's almost a guaranteed couple yards.
They get four on the play, so it's second and six for the East. Tanner DeYoung remaining as the quarterback.
They're playing quads on the wide side of the field here. We've seen that actually quite a lot from this East team.
Pressure comes. DeYoung dumps it off, and again, it's Adam Williams unable to haul it in.
Really good read by Colin Cornelson, the D-tackle out of Manitoba. Former teammate of mine, actually, the D-line coach there at University of Manitoba, Shaquille Armstrong. So he'd be happy to see that. Just read that, like I was saying before, just read that screen like a book. When you're a D-lineman and you realize that you're getting through way too easily, there's alarm bells going off. And then what do? You locate that running back, and he was able to break it up. So that's a good heads-up play by Colin Cornelson.
Punting team will come back on. Max Capriotti, high and fairly short one. No yards is going to be called, as it was hauled in by Basiliga. Shaken up player on the play is Jacob Mason out of McMaster. It's the first injury we've really had here this afternoon, as he looks into a great degree of discomfort right now.
Yeah. However, the silver lining to that is that, like you mentioned, it's been 2.5 quarters and we haven't seen any injuries.
The no yards call will march the ball into East territory at the 49-yard line. So great field position for the West once we get back to gameplay, though the concern right now is Jacob Mason, a fullback listed at 6'2", 240. And there's another one of those kind of high short punts in which you've got a lot of players, Andrew, converging.
While we're waiting on this, I was going to say there's a couple, the Jacobs or the Jakes, we see out of Alberta. So the combine here at East West, this year they used all of the exact same tools for 40, you name it, all the exact same measurements for absolutely everything. It was done by the CFL in conjunction with the CFL. So all the same measurements as the CFL combine, which they're using all the same as the NFL combine. For lasers, you name it. And the one caveat to that is that the outdoor events, which were the running events, were done in the rain. So there's a little bit of an asterisk, might be a bit slower. Jake Taylor from Alberta, overall the best. He had the best three cone, best shuttle, and the best vert. And ran a 4.67, 40.
Which in less than optimal conditions is outstanding.
Absolutely. And then we also do see Jake Kelly from Bishops, 39-inch vertical, fastest 40 at 37-inch vertical, I should say, fastest 40 at 4.53.
Wow. 37-inch vertical is awfully impressive. I need a step ladder and two brakes to get to 37 inches. So great field position, and Dueck will hand off the ball, and with good momentum, and picking up close to 9 yards is Jonathan Rosary out of Alberta.
So we saw a lot from Rosary in the first quarter, but we haven't seen a whole lot since.
7 yard pickup on that play. Twenty-six catches, 394 yards for Rosary, as 12 rushes, 76 yards. So use more as a receiver.
Yeah.
Second and three for Dueck. Hand off, and that is going to be no pickup on the play.
So a pretty nasty crack back there from Clark Barnes on the D end of Van Wishart.
So Rosary, no pickup, and it looks like the offense is staying on the field.
Third and about a full yard. So maybe it was just the field position last time. Maybe a little bit too far back for comfort, regardless of not having too much on the line in this game.
So the ball spotted just slightly beyond the 40-yard line. The measuring stick is right at the 39-yard line, so slightly over a yard here. Dweck behind center. Uses the right side and eyeballing it, looks to have pushed his way for the first down.
It would appear so. Like I said, if it's about a yard, maybe just over a yard, you should almost get that every time.
They haven't moved the chains officially yet.
They started to. Did you notice that?
Yes, I did.
They're waiting for all the referees to confer before the on-field officials to confer and get the official spot.
Are they bringing the chains on?
Which is interesting. Okay.
Well, they called it a first down, but now so they've got to move the...
Yeah, really interesting. And now there must have been a penalty because the ball is 5 yards further.
A flag was thrown on the far side of the field, so... That one goes against the east and moves it forward to the 35-yard line. And are we staring down the barrel potentially of our first touchdown here at the East-West Bowl? Dweck, delay, handoff, Rosary gets the legs moving, still moving, and he fumbled the ball! Oh, he had such a wonderful individual effort and second effort. And he fumbled the ball, and it fell right into the hands of Marcus Sean Loescher.
And you see that second effort is actually where he just made that second effort right there. And that's where the fumble occurred.
Might have been Maxime Lavallee who got there to strip the ball away.
I believe it was Lavallee who stripped it, and it was definitely Jean Loescher from St. Mary's with the recovery.
So it looked like West was making their way towards the red zone, and a turnover will do them in. And let's see if this will flip some momentum. DeYoung back to pass, and he's gonna look down the field, hangs up in the air, and it ends up actually with the East receiver Nathan Lupien playing defensive back as he knocked it away from Nico McCarthy from Laurier, who was defending.
Those long arms. Those long arms by Nathan Lupier, who was actually the slot back, was just ensuring that there wasn't going to be an interception. Almost a very defensive play on the offensive player.
6'3" is Lupier. Second and 10 for the East. They're at the 30-yard line. They'll scrimmage the ball just from the left hash mark. Chandler Fervia going in motion. They look across, and it's another drop.
We've seen more than our fair share of drops today.
So Retson Daly had it in his hands and lost it. Did have to reach behind him a little bit, Andrew, but that's a catchable ball.
Definitely catchable, I will say. You do make a really good point to his credit. He did have to stutter step and reach behind.
So Max Capriotti out of St. FX. Back on to punt. On a bounce, this time Barnes will be careful, and he lost it again, and it looked like it's going to be claimed by Lake Corte, who dove on the ball. No yards again will be the call, but boy, Barnes had a little bit more trouble handling that one.
Yeah, well, he let it roll, and it just took a weird kind of, what they would say in Hamilton here is an Argo bounce.
I see a few other things about the Argos here, too. We can't necessarily repeat, but yes. 4:03 to go in the third quarter. Again, good field position for Team West in the black. They will scrimmage the ball on their own 48-yard line.
So East in the white, West in the black for any new viewers. And the East is the RSEQ and the AUS plus Queens, Ottawa U, and Carleton.
First and 10, Andreas Dueck from McMaster. Pulls it back, throws good, solid throw, and a very good defensive play made by Maxime Lavallee, who interrupted Savon Magne-Jones on that reception.
Yeah, Lavallee, the ball hawk out of University of Montreal. Definitely a top DB out there in the RSEQ. Big part of that team that went all the way to the UTEC Bowl there against University of Saskatchewan that came right down to the wire, literally the last couple seconds of that game.
That was a classic for sure. Lavallee, 5'9", 195. So Dueck back to pass, has time, and then underthrows his intended receiver, Magne-Jones. So again, very good field position for the West will be wasted with 3:16 to go in the third quarter. The punting unit back on. The one thing we should note about these players as well is the pandemic shortened the season for many, certainly did in the OUA. You lost a season, so you've got guys who normally would be coming into what their third, fourth year who are a lot more inexperienced than normally they would be.
And those are really the huge developmental years are the year one, year two, early on in the off season of the going into your third year. That's really where you go from becoming a boy to a man in this man's game and able to play with the best.
So where normally you would be playing 8 to 10 game regular seasons, now the only 6 in Ontario, and obviously different numbers throughout the country, but losing a whole season as well. Very, very short kick with the wind. Another no yards penalty is coming, and cutting it to the outside was Fervius. He made a good attempt to turn the corner and was shoved out of bounds at about the 44-yard line. Flags on the play. That was a nice move.
Yep. Little stutter step. Yeah, well, I recall at the start of the season, the RSEQ was already on week 2, and the OUA had just had week 3 in the RSEQ was the first week in the OUA. The AUS is usually about a week behind, but now that they have bishops in the AUS, they're pretty much starting at the same length as the other conferences.
With a 6-game season in the OUA this year, the mathematics were almost impossible to determine when it came down to the last week of the season and the various scenarios that were in play.
All the combinations. You'd have to get a PhD student to break it down.
Yep. And I am not a PhD student, and we were trying to, a few of us. DeYoung, nice little pitch and catch. It's complete. Looks like it's going to be good for a first down. Retson Daly hauling that one in.
DeYoung pass is complete to number 17, Retson Daly.
So give him a little more than 10 yards on the catch and move the chains.
That's good enough for a TD. First down.
Retson Daly has been a favorite target of DeYoung throughout the day.
Carlton quarterback throwing to a York wide receiver. DeYoung back to pass again, throws the deep out, and it is going to be caught on the right side. Nice catch by Demetrius Masuka, who hauled it in. Nico McCarthy on the coverage.
Yeah, great ball, solid on a line. And you know what? The funny thing about those wide side field throws on the opposite hash mark, that's about a 35-yard toss for a 9-yard gain.
So second and one. DeYoung had Bladen got into two games this year for Carlton, 34 for 55, 555 yards, three touchdowns and an interception. So good production in the limited time. And you can see he has a very good arm.
Great arm. You don't often see that, a east-west quarterback with only a couple games from the previous season.
On the delay, it's a handoff, and not getting the yards on the for the first down was Olivier Catterett. A little bit of a delay, and it's going to be third and short.
Yeah, it appeared to be a read option on the draw. And if that was the read option, possibly not the right call. But you never know what the actual read is, and that's why we're up here speculating. We don't know if it was a certain D-tackle or DN that he's reading.
So losing a yard and bringing the punting unit on, Team East. So Capriotti back on again. I thought, again, you were in that placement in the field where you might have gone for it, but it remains West 3, East 1. Here at Ron Joyce Stadium.
This is, in fact, the score of this football game, not
yes.
a hockey game here on campus.
Well, it hasn't been hockey at McMaster in a long time, so. Capriotti, this is a good kick. And to the left side, he managed to get a few yards before slipping, going out of bounds. Daniel Perry out of Saskatchewan. 36.3 seconds to go here in the third quarter. No scoring so far in the third.
Speaking of Perry, with Baker from U of S going to the CFL, or at least getting drafted there, Perry is going to be that number one receiver from Saskatchewan. And that's that U of S team that went all the way to the UTech Bowl in Montreal, intimidating place to play, and then went all the way to the Vanier Cup, losing to Western, of course.
Perry had an outstanding season as well, Andrew. 35 catches for 650 yards and five touchdowns. Dweck, lots of time to throw. Scampers away from the rush of Alexander Dubois. Will keep the ball and slide at
Smart.
The 35-yard line, picking up 6 yards on the play.
Yeah, after we saw a couple big hits on the quarterbacks earlier in the game, definitely a smart play to make, the slide. Good heads-up play to run. Got the 6 or so yard gain.
And this will be, unless there's a penalty, the last play of the third quarter. They give Dweck about the 5. They actually marked him at the 34, where he started his slide, not where he ended his slide. Backfield is empty.
Blitz off the edge.
On the jet sweep, well read by the defense, as trying to test the left side was Jonathan Rosary.
And a really good pursuit there by the blitz off the edge from the Ottawa linebacker, James Peter. Eventually actually getting to the jet sweep, to the ball carrier.
So that is the last play of the third quarter. West 3, East 1. And again, we saw some signs that teams were starting to move the ball. A couple more drop passes, but a real good job, I think, overall by the defenses so far.
Yeah, I mean, it's been a game of defenses, but we did see 3 first downs in a row on that one sustained drive, really driven by Dweck and that West team. Overall, West in the lead right now, 3-1. In totality of the 18 matchups between this East-West team, dating all the way back to 2003, West has 10 wins, East has 8 wins. Not that it really accounts for anything, per se.
But we like to keep track of these things.
Yeah, stats. And the funny thing is, before Carleton came back, York was part of the West, and now they're back in the East. And it's really funny when you look at East because, or sorry, West, most of the Ontario schools, although geographically in the East, are actually on Team West. So it's really funny when you look at it that way, too. Just goes to show how spread out the Canada West Conference is, where they're taking flights to almost every, like UBC and University of Manitoba have to fly everywhere.
Absolutely, yes. Everything within Ontario is drivable, and that's even when you're making the Ottawa-Windsor trek, which is my guess, one of the least exciting drives that you could participate in.
Glad I never had to do that.
Third and three, punting unit has come on. High snap over the head of the kicker, and now what's he going to do? Just tries to kick it on the run, and it's caught at the 33-yard line by number 21, Pierre-Olivier Cataratte, who almost had the necessary space to take it back. But boy, that was a strange play as James Parker had to track all the way back and do what he could.
Oh, Dane with the pressure. Cataratte. Seemed like he had the space at first, and then it quickly closed in on him. So this is the best field position that we've seen on the right-hand side of this field so far, and probably for the East team.
And unfortunate for James Parker, that will go down in the books as a 7-yard punt, as a big stick on Demetrius Masuka, who took it from James Keenan, who's back into the game, quarterbacking for the East from Queens. For a late game replacement, Demetrius Masuka certainly getting his reps here this afternoon.
Yeah, he was literally called in for relief this morning, and he's you've said his name probably more than most.
Second and 6, 4-yard pickup. Keenan completed almost 61% of his passes last year for Queens. They went all the way to the OUA final, and he's dragged down at the 35-yard line. A loss of 12 on the play. Lake Corte got him.
Shoestrings. We actually saw him earlier in the game miss one by shoestrings, so he must feel good getting that one. If you recall, at the top left of your screen, it was him and Dueck, and he had just missed Dueck.
Big, rangy, 6'5", 248-pound defensive end from UBC.
Long arms, long body, able to stretch out. That's what you look for at the next level, too.
And it forces Capriotti and the East out of field goal range and into a punting situation. Capriotti tried a 49-yarder that fell about 3 or 4 yards short. That was with the wind. 42 yards, which was his longest this year, would have been the attempt here against the wind. So the East will opt to play the field position game.
You know what? This is no different than the field position we saw on the other side of the field for that attempt. But it's just going against the wind now is the major difference.
Barnes will pick it up, picks his way across the 10, and then gets driven back at the 13 as we get a little bit of a scrum away from the ball between Ethan Martin of the East and Patrick Burke Jr. at the West.
I feel like a lot of these guys are getting antsy. Time dwindling down, want to get some action if they haven't already.
Also spent the week together too, so maybe the
you know what?
Little sick and tired of the guy, maybe.
Absolutely. You learn to love some of these guys in the lunchroom, in the meeting room. When you're going one-on-one against some of these guys every day, you learn to hate them.
13:09 to go in the fourth quarter. West 3, East 1. It is West ball.
I will say there's a lot of camaraderie that comes out of this week. These guys become friends for, if not a lifetime of a long while.
So interestingly enough, Andreas Dueck remains in the game. He's going to throw the deep ball towards Clark Barnes, who almost pulled it in. It was great defense by Jason States McLean out of SMU.
Borderline maybe a bit of a pass interference. The refs are pretty lenient today. We saw a little bit of a tug right there on Barnes right before, but I used to play defense, so I don't mind that. Beautiful arm, though. Really well-thrown ball. Potentially even a little underthrown.
So you wonder if Josh Donnelly got banged up a little bit in that first quarter. That's why Dueck is playing the last three, where he's back on in the fourth quarter.
Well, we did see him get cracked in the ribs there when he went for the run. Oh,
another big stick, and the one who delivered it, Felix Petit, is slow to react. It was a great run by Uwanchina, who will get the first down yardage. But my goodness, a vicious hit stopped him after he picked up 15 yards on the carry.
Beautiful downhill running. So that's Josh Chewy Uwanchina. I'm being told by Colton Klassen that he's a human truck stick. Colton Klassen was their second string running back there at U of S this year. And from him to say that he is Uwanchina or Chewy, a human hit stick, that's a pretty big accolade because Colton was one himself.
So Felix Petit will walk off the field, and my guess is they will get him into a concussion protocol to check, because that was an awful lick that he delivered, really, to try to stop the momentum.
Very reminiscent of Chris Pizzetta, who used to play here at McMaster, who I used to play with in high school in minor football.
Well, Dweck had a receiver, Basaliga. He overthrew him substantially, so it's incomplete. And yeah, Chris Pizzetta was something of a legend here. He came back from so many injuries.
Three ACLs, I think?
Three ACLs and still was churning in his fifth year.
It was unbelievable. And at the same time, there was also there was a handful of really good running backs, and he was still able to, after all these injuries, get a lot of playing time. Joey Nemeth there at the beginning, and then it'll come to me afterwards.
First or second and 10, 29-yard line. Again, they keep it on the ground. Maybe a 3 or 4 yard pickup. There's first touch for Justin Sukar, a receiver out of Waterloo.
Nice downhill running. And you know what? That was inside zone blocking. Nothing crazy about it. Your standard hard-nosed Canadian football right there.
Probably the best flow of the game.
Easily the best hair of the game. I wish there was an award for best flow of the game here.
I mean, I don't sure if you're allowed to, but I mean, if you're running off the field, you got to take the helmet off and let it blow in the breeze. You got a good wind here to
some Troy Polamalu style.
Pick is going to be blocked. And it's going to be Keon Edwards fighting for it along with number 7 on the East, James Peter. Great pursuit and a block.
So there was a number change. And you know what? There was a number change to 44. You know what? It was 50. That is unfortunate for our roster, unless we have our updated one here, because that deserves a shout out on the block.
So the
that was actually Alexandre Desbois from Laval, the D tackle.
So wonderful job by him, and it's the 21-yard line, almost the red zone. Handoff, cutting.
Nice.
On the jet sweep to the outside. Can he turn the corner? Yes, he can. And shoved out of bounds. That was Shedler Fervius out of SMU.
Beautiful run. That jet sweep motion. That extra move and able to turn the corner beyond the sticks and get that first down.
A late flag came out, and I'm not sure if it fell out of the pocket of the official or whether there was an infraction. Might have been a late hit out of bounds. It's going to be first and goal.
The best scoring opportunity we've seen since that second drive, which was once again also on the 1 yard line.
So James Keenan, quarterback, a very good rusher, though he doesn't need many yards here. 48 carries, 301 yards. And let's see if he keeps himself behind that huge, massive offensive line. Oh, he's going to hand it off, and it's going to be a touchdown. Adam Williams will get the touchdown. A nice moment, as he's had a couple of tough moments here this afternoon, but he puts the first major on the scoreboard.
Great point. That must feel amazing for Adam Williams. He got a little too excited on his first attempted reception, and now making up for that. Hopping over. The D-line did a good job. They submarined right at the the ankles there of the O-line, just hopping over and into the end zone.
Great job by the offensive line. You saw Ryan Berta out of Quebec, 6'3", 292, part of the blocking.
6 feet, 215. That's a pretty solid running back right there. Not someone that you want to run into too often.
So the special teams turnover turns into a touchdown for the East, and Capriotti on to add the extra point, which he does, and 10:08 to go in the fourth quarter. East 8, West 3, and business will pick up now, Andrew, after we've got our first major on the scoreboard.
I really give a big shout out to Alexandre Dubois from Laval with that punt block. The speed as a D tackle going right into the backfield of that special team beating the up back. It's not something to go unnoticed.
6 feet, 240 as well, so it's not like he's got the longest arms or the tallest guy in the world, so good for him.
We see finally got the corner on that jet sweep motion for Team East.
Capriotti will kick it off. Barnes and Uinchina are back deep to receive.
Scores 8-3. Biggest major of the game. And surprisingly enough, it's on the right side of the field here.
That's right. Capriotti in the direction of Barnes, who has to take it in a hop, and it bounces past him. And he will pick up nothing as he gets driven backwards.
Yeah.
Tough day for the kick returners with this wind.
And he had enough time to get under that ball, but it seems like a lot of these returners with the wind are just allowing it to bounce around, and that didn't take the right bounce for him.
They gave him a little bit of a break on the spot at the 19-yard line where he was first driven back. And again, it does remain Andreas Dueck in the game. Josh Donnelly out of Regina played the first quarter. Dueck since, and Dueck, lots of time but no options, so he flushes it out to the left, still dancing, still darting, now cuts to the outside and slides down at about the 19-yard line, actually ended up back at the original line of scrimmage after all of that.
Did you notice that block by Juwan Jeffrey to allow that to happen, that rollout? Wearing 27 and from Guelph, really reminiscent after that block of Johnny Augustine, who is now a Grey Cup champion with Winnipeg. Johnny Augustine, one of the strongest running backs I've ever seen, does not shy away from blocking, and really, that was a big, big play there.
And he was
from Juwan.
Fantastic running back for Guelph as well.
Absolutely.
Dueck back to pass, is locked onto the right side, throws it to the right side, and dropping the ball. And they will rule that one incomplete. Justin Sukar had yards and green field in front of him, but couldn't haul it in.
Pass intended for number 82, Justin Sukar.
Could have been a case made for that being a fumble. Could have.
Not full possession, so definitely the right call. But that's not the first time we've seen. That's the second time we've seen today, right in and around that same area where a receiver should have caught it. Maybe getting a little too ahead of themselves, thinking of moving upfield before actually securing the ball. And now we're in a punt situation.
So it hasn't been a fun time for James Parker. The last two times he's punted, once it's been snapped over his head and he was able to get off a 7-yarder, and the last one he had was blocked. And East looks like they might be coming after this one too. Low snap, and he does get it off.
They definitely did have some pressure on that one.
Return to about the 40-yard line by Jake Kelly from Bishops. Good field position again.
East is really making a big push right now. And nice, got to say, a nice tackle there by Connor DeLahey of Saskatchewan. Just on the note of that block there by Juan Jeffrey, the O-line coach of Guelph, recently retired Mike McDonald, made a point to tell me before the game that he is a very good blocker. And that's coming from an O-line coach about a running back.
Certainly proved to be true. Ball is underthrown from James Keenan out to the left side, intended for Demetrius Masuka. Second and 10 from the 40.
Yeah, the East looked a little bit more flat in the first half. In this fourth quarter, they're really bringing the heat.
Special teams has given them great field position, one of which they turned into a touchdown, a one-yard run from Adam Williams. Second and 10 here for James Keenan of Queens to work with. He drops the snap, and he is up, and he's running, and he's turning the corner, and he's sliding down around the 32-yard line was where he started the slide. There's a flag down at the 50, though.
You'll also notice after this recovery, a really nice block by Siobhan Magny Jones Zero right there. And that's the slot back from Western.
Unfortunately, it looked like it was holding. So they'll back it up, second and 20 from the 50-yard line now.
A couple plays ago, that aforementioned Connor DeLahey from Saskatchewan touted as one of the hardest hitting defensive players out there in the Can West. So a big shout out to him, because we haven't said his name a whole lot.
If you're one of the bigger hitters out from Can West, that's saying something as well. So Keenan, second and 20. Read option.
Nice.
And a beautiful run back to the original line of scrimmage by Adam Williams. He picks up 10, and it's third and 10.
Not enough for field goal position going into the wind, but ultimately a nice run for him, and that's what this East-West Bowl is all about. And better field position for the punt.
He punted from the 40-yard line. There's a good look. Familiar face, the pinball. He could probably step back in and return a couple kicks now, as now, of course, he's president of the Toronto Argos.
You know, Chad Owens actually did that at University of Hawaii, where his son is now a backup quarterback. He was there at their spring camp game doing some returns. Chad Owens, obviously, from the Toronto Argos and the Hamilton Tiger Cats here.
Great job cutting it to the outside.
Number 87, Daniel Perry,
to get to the 25-yard line. I think we're going to have our 23rd no yards penalty of the afternoon.
Yeah, it's one of those things that officials and leagues always go back and forth on. How can we diminish no yards and not make it super egregious, but also keep it safe? And that's just the one very uniquely Canadian thing about Canadian football, is the no yards halo. Yeah.
Looking at pinball, Clements obviously doing some scouting, pre-scouting for the Argos. CFL camp scheduled to get underway within the next month, pending, of course, them coming to an agreement. Negotiations seemingly a little stalled right now, but plenty of time to get a deal done.
Yep. Yeah, a lot of big names to that Argos team this year.
Good catch, Clark Barnes, open field, 50, cuts it back inside, midfield and inside of East Territory. That was a wonderful connection, Dueck to Barnes, 23 yards for the first down.
About 10 yards of yak right there, yards after catch. Probably about 30 yards side to side, but 10 yards total. Maybe more of a possession receiver there.
Barnes, 29 catches for 406 yards this year. That was in limited time as well. He missed a game or two. Dueck back to pass, settles into the pocket, over the middle, it's caught! And to the 30-yard line and inside the 30-yard line, Jawan Jeffery. So Andreas Dueck loving himself some Guelph Griffins as a second straight connection for a first down.
Any way we can make this a six-quarter game? We're finally getting some really nice, exciting offensive production here.
26 yards on that connection, 5:40 and running to go as Dueck marches the West down the field. Back to pass again, and this time Barnes can't haul it in. Incomplete.
Yeah, these Guelph receivers are favorites of Dueck in this quarter, pretty much throughout the game as well. Speaking of additional quarters, there's been three East-West that have actually gone to overtime. So some preseason games you'll see coaches will cap it off. No, we don't need to do overtime. Friendlies, things like that. The East-West will go to overtime.
8-3, so we're going to have to do some score hijinks to get it to overtime.
Yeah. Canadian football, you never know.
That is true. Second and 10 for Dueck. In the pocket with time to throw, looking down the field. Now he steps up and will run, ducks the head. Good run by Dueck. He's inside the 15-yard line. 14 yards and a first down.
Really quick decision to just call his own number. Really smart veteran move there. Had no open receivers, made his reads. There was some openings. I really like that play call by Dueck.
Zendro Audane out of Carlton making the tackle on the play. And here we go, first and 10 from the 13.
Both defenses a little on their heels.
Three straight first downs for the West. Keon Edwards lined up beside Dueck. Ooh. And that read option was read quite well, thank you very much, by Ethan Martin out of Quebec, because he stacked up and dropped Keon Edwards for a loss.
And by Quebec, you mean Queens.
Queens, sorry.
There you go.
I see the QUE, yes.
I've had to do a couple double takes on our rosters here.
Second and 14, a loss of four on the play for Edwards. Dueck back to pass, looking, and it is caught.
Open.
And can he get to the end zone? It's a touchdown! James Basaliga able to weave his way in for the major, and the West has retaken the lead, 9-8.
James Basaliga, who was a favorite target of Trey Ford at the University of Waterloo this year. We've said his name a lot and was able to hurdle over Jake Kelly of Bishops right there at the end. Really great ball. And nice little flip there. A little artistic. Now they're going for two.
Yeah, with a one-point lead, they will keep the offense on the field and try and add the two-point conversion. With your offense in rhythm, why not?
Exactly. They have the momentum right now. From a score standpoint, it only makes sense. You'll still remain with the lead. Field goal would be a tie. If they just went for one, then easy field goal for a win.
3:33 to go in the fourth quarter, and finally we're going back and forth with the offenses starting to convert. So let's see what Dueck has for the two-point conversion. He's looking to the right. He's now going to try and go himself, and can he get in the end zone? Oh, what a great move by Dueck to dive in for the two-point conversion at the end. It was the stutter. It was the step to get the two-point conversion.
The extra effort, the shimmy, the juke, and then the dive. Just no hesitation. You know what? With Dueck, it's effortless. It's just the decision's made. If his read's not there, he's going for it.
You realize we use the term shimmy, juke, and stutter step all to describe that five-yard run.
Exactly.
11-8 West.
I mean, it's not wrong.
No.
Maybe excessive in the buzzwords, but not wrong.
So Andreas Duet giving the hometown fans a little something to cheer of. Of course, he plays for McMaster University.
Big shout out to McMaster from all of the U Sports in the CFL for hosting this. They were a huge integral part of that. Steph Potasik as well. Head coach Stefan Potasik. Vanier Cup champion 2011.
You know, I'm biased being a McMaster guy, but they really do things first class here at McMaster, whether it's volleyball, basketball, or football, and they've put on a great show all week long here for this East-West Bowl, as that return will be made by Pierre-Olivier Cadaret as he gets out of bounds. And now your overtime scenario is looking a lot better now with a three-point deficit.
Exactly. See, somewhat of an oracle myself. However, you know just as well as I that these Canadian football games with more stoppages after the three-minute warning and rouges and field possession having, like, conceding a safety for field possession, anything's really possible in the last 5 minutes.
And they could get that 3 points by a safety and a rouge as a pass is completed. And a great move out on the right side. Now the offenses are starting out of bounds near the 34-yard line as Demetrius Masuka.
As we mentioned, Masuka was actually a last second addition, to the roster after an injury from Charles Jehu from Sherbrooke. Was able to just get around Nico McCarthy from Wilfrid Laurier.
So he gets to the 39-yard line, first and 10 for the East to operate as they look to move the ball back down the field. Masuka, another catch on the wide receiver screen, and goodness me, with no regard for human decency at all, Jack Hinsberger pancaked him.
Hit stick there by the linebacker out of Waterloo.
Three hard-fought yards on the pickup for Masuka.
Masuka really making the most out of this. Maybe it's those fresh legs from not practicing 2 days all week.
So hitting the three-minute warning, officially at 2:51 to go here in the fourth quarter. The East looking to respond to the West. And the touchdown drive led by Andreas Dueck with a connection to James Basiliga. Second and six, they will move it up a yard.
Seen both the East and the West in this fourth quarter string together three consecutive first downs, so it's possible. Could see them march down the field.
As you said, with Canadian football rules, plenty of time as the clock starts to move, 2:45 and running to go in the fourth quarter. Keenan back to pass, just settles in, and it's incomplete as Fervius tried to pick it off the turf.
Nice dive. Low ball. Not much that he could do there.
Third and six, and now James Keenan looking to the sidelines, and it doesn't seem to be a movement from the special teams, so.
They're going for it. Might as well. What do you have to lose, really?
Keep the offense on the field. 49-yard line is where the East needs to get to for a first down. And Keenan is just as good a scrambler as he is a passer, and the pocket will collapse, and he's flushed out to the left. He is going to throw the ball. What a great
oh!
play on defense as it ended up. It was Jake Taylor out of Alberta who flattened Demetrius Masuka, who looked like he hauled in that ball.
Look at this edge rush here by 55 on the left of your screen. The little rip and dip added that additional pressure and actually allowed for that hit stick there by Jake Taylor from Alberta.
Ryan Leader from McMaster on that pursuit.
Said his name a couple times. Great size, 6'2", 235 on his home turf.
And it was a nice throw across his body by James Keenan as well from the quarterback position.
It really was. It was just a really well done play from both sides.
So Team West in the black will take over at the 43-yard line of Team East. And Andreas Dueck will hand the ball off to Uinchina.
Saw some really interesting defensive schematics there where the field half started to drop into that free safety position and the safety rolled down. But there was no blitz showing.
Place the ball just beyond the 40-yard line. A 4-yard pickup for Uinchina. Second and 6. Now the whistle will go. It looked like the time clock had winded down.
Either a time count violation or a
clock malfunction.
Yeah.
No real signal or no flag thrown on the play. So
let's give it a clock malfunction, I guess.
So second and 6 for Andreas Dueck. 39-yard line is where he operates from.
Some audibles.
And the wide receiver screen dropped by Clark Barnes, and whatever audible was ran didn't work in the end.
A little behind him. So make it 3rd and about 6. Good field position just outside of field goal territory. Looking like a punt. They have the lead.
Would be a 46-yard field goal should they go that.
Mind you, we saw the 49-yarder go about 8 yards too short. So
we haven't seen James Parker try one at all.
Right. It was East that attempted from here.
Yeah. And he will punt this time.
Probably just try to cough and corner it. Get some good field position.
Bad snap. It's over his head. Late response by the East, and nice little move, and then he's still going, and down he goes at the 50-yard line. Another special teams error made.
Xandru O'Dane looking like he actually got the tackle in the end from Carlton after 3 missed tackles prior, but definitely a second bad snap of the quarter.
So 2 bad snaps and a block, James, unfortunately.
James Peter, was actually the one who had the tackle in the end. So now
James Keenan will lead the offense back onto the field. 1st and 10 from the 50-yard line of the West. Good field position. 11-8, West with a 3-point lead. Keenan back to pass and overthrows his intended target, Retson Daly.
Easily the favorite target of the day today, Retson Daly.
So 2nd and 10.
With the wind against them, even though they only need a field goal, it won't be an easy one. So they're going to try to go all the way.
And if they're out of field goal range, likely in 3 down territory as well. Let's see what James Keenan has to offer up. Second and 10. Pressure comes from Leader, throws it down the field, and it's overthrown, intended for Daly, and Jace Jackson Ford from Regina made a diving attempt to intercept it. Third down and 10 in decision time.
Once again, Retson Daly, the targeted receiver. He has a knack for getting open, I'll give him that. But also there is a bit of a shortage of receivers here. A couple injuries early on, hence the fill-in from Demetrius Masuka and so on. Early on, I mean prior to the game, if you will.
Third and 10 from the 50-yard line. Keenan, pocket, time to throw, looking downfield, and it is dropped. Daly again was the intended target.
So much time in the pocket there, too.
Ife Onyemenem from Wilfrid Laurier on the defense.
Pretty high ball. Trying to climb the ladder there, Retson Daly. But yeah, definitely, he possibly could have come down with it if it weren't for Ife Onyemenem from Laurier.
So taking over on downs is Team West at the 50-yard line. Lots of time, 1:36 to go. Both timeouts as well for the East. Dueck, handoff, got a good block and scampering across midfield. Jonathan Rosary with a nice pickup on first down.
Yeah, Justin Sukar with the nice block there, a nice seal block. That's yet another receiver out of Waterloo.
7-yard pickup, and if you're still delivering good blocks like that with a minute and a half left after a tough week, good for you.
You know, those are the things that get noticed by any, as a Canadian, especially by any CFL scout, coach, etc., because they know that they need you for those ratios on special teams just as much as they need you on offense or defense. Although there has been some chatter about the ratios changing and whatnot within the CFL, there is no official change to that just yet. And I don't suspect that happening at all.
Yeah, that chatter, I think it will and should dissipate real quick.
Absolutely. But I also feel like it will in some forums and some people and some circles last forever.
All sorts of discussion, four down football in the CFL, Canadian ratios.
Americans that played in the CFL and have and currently do play in the CFL are not fans of that change. And you'd have to rewrite the record books totally.
There's a large segment of fans in the United States who love CFL football and all the anomalies. And
yeah. Well, it really is a passing game, too.
Yeah.
Which they love.
Hand off. Keon Edwards tries to string it out on second and three and comes up a couple yards short of the first down.
A lot of Americans that watch Ivy League or watch, like, say, Hawaii, they love Canadian ball because a lot of those programs will play a very pass-heavy, pass-intensive game, very similar and akin to the CFL. Then you have teams like Army and Navy that are running the read option.
Yep.
Completely different from any other leagues anywhere.
And there were still run-heavy programs as well. They still like to run the old wishbone offense.
Yeah. Well, even Echeverry, back when he was coaching U Ottawa in like 2013, tried to bring in the wing T. It didn't do too well, mind you, but he tried to bring the wing T back to U Ottawa.
Flag thrown on the play was against the East, so the ball will move to the 47-yard line of the East. But we love the three-down game. The 110-yard field and all the other great Canadian rules that come with it is not a whole lot of room on the left side for Rosary to work with. Maybe 2 yards on the pickup as we wind down to a minute 19 to go in the fourth.
At this point, they're just going to play out the play clock as long as possible, keep running. If they do any passing, ensure that it stays in bounds, but unlikely.
one timeout left for the East now, as they will spend one.
Perfect day for football. Perfect football weather, minus a little bit more wind than ideal, but the temperature is fantastic. It's about 9 degrees or so, which in this sun with no clouds, once you're playing there on the hot turf, feels like 15 to 20.
I've seen anything from toques and jackets to shorts and t-shirts in the crowd here
right
this afternoon. I even saw some fans getting involved in some tailgating before the game.
Really?
Yes.
I missed that memo.
I hovered around hoping for an invite, but none was forthcoming. Second and 8. Big play here for Andreas Dueck. Handoff. Keon Edwards has a hole. Darts through it. Still going. 30-yard line. 25-yard line. And dragged down. 15-yard line. And the 1,200-yard-plus runner from Western finally breaks one all the way down the field.
And there's a reason that he had 6 100-plus-yard games there for Western. And another reason why Western is the Vanier Cup champions.
30-yard pickup.
First is 10 of the 15.
And now, with no timeouts left, it's looking a little more bleaker for the East, though there's still some work for Andreas Dueck to do, and he might want to try and punch another one in here. Hand off to Rosary, who picks his way down to the 5-yard line before getting tackled by Alexandra Deblois. Some back-to-back runs.
From Keon Edwards to Rosary, both OUA running backs.
Clock is moving. 10 on the play clock. About a 26-22 differential as Andreas Dueck will be patient. Edwards beside him. Edwards with the handoff. He sees the end zone. Does he get there? He looks like he's short.
Just short. And the beautiful thing about these last three runs is they're really simple inside zone blocking schemes, just that really standard Canadian football. These running backs, both veterans, able to find the crease.
Didn't get into the end zone, but did get a first down for his team.
Remember what happened last time we saw this field position? Right on the left-hand side of the field.
And Keon Edwards, who just ripped off a 30-plus yard run, thanks you for reminding him of what happened in the first quarter. But you're right, it was a fumble on first and goal from the 1-yard line.
So anyone that came a little bit late to the broadcast, that happened in the early on in the first quarter.
And the time clock will wind down with 3.3 seconds to go. Andreas Dueck, he looked like he was trying to signal the timeout. So let's see if they either got the timeout in or they'll back him up 5 yards. Another clock error. So out of the, really almost out of the pistol, it's Dueck, handoff, Edwards, tackled, and he's not going to get him, but wait a second.
There's
a flag down on the play, so don't roll the credits yet on this one. The teams are slowly walking on the field, but if it's a defensive penalty, we can play another down. And it is a defensive penalty, which they will decline, and that's the ball game.
Yeah, as we assumed, the second half was a lot more exciting on the offensive side of things. Couple first downs, finally sustained drives. A touchdown.
Yes. Throwing touchdown.
Yep.
Running touchdown.
A little bit of everything. Definitely a slower first half. That's almost always the case in these All-Star games, these East-West bowl games. You get these players where they understand that this is a really big opportunity. But we saw some really good breakouts.
There's the score, West 11, East 8. But before we wrap things up here, I just want to get your take on what sorts of things are scouts looking for with these players? I mean, obviously, statistics will tell part of the game here. But obviously, if you're a scout, you've got a lot of different things you're looking at.
Yeah, so when you're looking at this game per se, you're looking at those things like finishing the play to the echo of the whistle. You're looking at the guys on special teams giving it their all, even though they've played all game on offense or defense. And lastly, I would say the guys that can maybe be that transitionary where they are a free safety right now, but they could actually be like a half or something in the CFL. Or right now they're a will backer, but they could be a Sam backer in the CFL. Something like that where it might not be as obvious, right? Because now you're actually seeing them up against the best guys. Ultimately, how do they fare against individuals who are just as good, if not better than them, in the opposite side of the field? But then from there, looking forward, how do these guys progress next year? How do their numbers at the combine get better? Undoubtedly, having the field events outside as opposed to in the dome, you want them to improve. But how much more are they going to improve? How much better is so-and-so going to get in the off season with those one-on-ones throughout the actual season? How do they show up? Do they get bigger? Do they get stronger? Are they losing the bad weight that they need to? What is it, the things that they do between now and then, even go much further than just today's performance? Because there's going to be breakout guys next year that weren't invited to this, and they are going to have a chip on their shoulder, and they're going to come out even stronger, and they're going to surprise people, and they will get drafted.
Well, there'll be a few stars that will emerge out of this game, no doubt about that, as we turn the page on the East-West Bowl and start to look forward to a summer that will feature more training camps and a full season of university football. And that's the big thing here, is a full season of university football for these athletes who sacrifice so much. I mean,
finally.
You know it. You were a five-year guy who said you spent a couple more years due to injuries.
Yeah.
And, you know, at Concordia, and I'm glad you didn't break out any Concordia fight songs here this afternoon. And so, great job here. I've got to thank the CFL who helped put all of this together. Of course, they want to see all of these players, to McMaster University, to all the guys here, Adam Marshall and Jamie, who all, and the other great camera people who made things look so good. And of course, a pleasure. Haven't worked with you before, but
yeah,
glad
Steve.
To do it. And let's hope that we get to do it again.
Absolutely, Steve.
Down
that
the road.
Sounds like a plan. And of course, can't forget U Sports. Thank you to the U Sports.
Absolutely. U Sports football, it'll be back. August is when the season will start. Final score here, West 11, East 8. You've been watching it via the McMaster YouTube channel and U Sports from Ron Joyce Stadium. Thank you for watching. Good day from McMaster. I'm Steve Clark for Andrew Barlett. Take care.